welcome to the Heritage Hall Class of 2020 graduation. We are here to acknowledge and celebrate all of the efforts of this class, all of the sacrifices, the victories, the friendships, and this community. With this being said, I'd like to reflect on some of the specialties of this class. Although I may be slightly biased, this class is truly spectacular. I have been with them for 15 years, and I still can't quite explain how exceptional they are in so many facets. Some of the following terms have been overused and have therefore lost some of their value unless truly considered. So please listen carefully to my next few words. This class is remarkably talented, unwaveringly special, and shockingly humble. We have artists like Reagan and Blair. We have musicians like Cooper, Thomas, and Audrey. We have athletes like Will and Philip. We have scientists like Hayden, Sukanya, and Nate. We have debaters like Seth and Alex. And even more impressively, we have 81 more unmentioned students whose talents could place them too in countless sections. So at the end of the day, we have 93 students who hold so much potential for the future. Of course, it is practically the duty of any commencement speaker to claim that their class holds limitless potential. Anybody can claim this because arguably everybody has the chance to create great change and positivity in this world. This is a remarkably hopeful thought. But even more supremely galvanizing is the fact that this class is leaps and bounds closer to this chance. There are brilliant students in this class. There are great communicators. There are inspiring leaders, and there are innovators. But most of all, they have grit, which is the only thing that allows anything else to matter. I am so grateful to be in this special class, and I am grateful for everyone here who came to honor these efforts of the 93 students here. Onward, Chargers.
Hello, everyone. First, I would like to thank everyone who has helped us to get to this point. So thank you to our teachers, mentors, counselors, families, parents, grandparents, and of course, senior sponsors and coaches for making our Heritage Hall experience one of a kind. We couldn't have done it without all of you, and we want you to know we appreciate you all so much. Some of you are here today in person, while others are watching virtually, but either way, we are truly grateful to everyone who has stuck by us throughout the years. Now, I want to thank all of my classmates. Heritage Hall is an absolutely amazing community, and we are very lucky to be a part of this Charger family. That becomes even more important during tumultuous times like these. We have to carry that kindness, leadership, and sense of community with us to help make others' lives better. It makes me incredibly proud to graduate with such an accomplished, talented, and caring group of people. I remember when I first came to Heritage Hall as a freshman. I was quiet and nervous to be in a daunting new school. As many of the athletes in the audience might know, injuries, especially when you have crutches, are absolutely miserable. Except there is one upside to this. It means that you can finally use the most magical, most desired thing in all of Heritage Hall, the elevator. Anyway, at the time, I was a competitive gymnast, and I had to be in a walking boot and crutches. That was when I realized how kind people are here. I was so thankful when my new friends would open doors for me, and I'm still grateful to Mr. Bramble for providing me and my friends with a wagon so I wouldn't have to hobble around. Little things like that make this community so great. Now, having spent more time with each other and somehow finishing high school, we are much more confident than we were 4 years ago when we began our journeys. When we go to college, we may go to a virtual university, an actual college, or a blend of the two. But either way, we will still feel the same way we did 4 years ago, unsure and apprehensive. In the end, we just have to remember two things. One is that, as Tom Magliozzi from Car Talk put it, we will never have more energy or enthusiasm, hair, or brain cells than we do today. The second is that in these next 4 years, they will go by in a flash. And soon again, we will be standing where we are today, but as college graduates. There are so many wonderful things about our high school experience, and that will be something we can look back on fondly. The relationships we have built with parents, faculty, and others have changed our lives for the better, and we will hold on to those for the rest of our lives. On a bigger scale, though, as a community, I've noticed that whenever one of us gets hurt, everyone else always comes to support us. And we have made our community a better place through mentoring, volunteering, and through working. I know that we will carry these core values with us into adulthood, and I'm confident that we, as a class, will thrive in this world and help others to do the same. Now, we are not like any other graduating class. Not only are we made of unique individuals, but we have demonstrated our strength, commitment, and perseverance in these last few months. Reading and watching the news, it seems the circumstances are only worsening. As more statistics are revealed on American deaths, the more somber and serious our world grows. Even now, while celebrating our high school accomplishments, we are also faced with difficult questions, whether they are about COVID-19 or racial tensions and police brutality. It may be true to say that the world and the future are calling. This can be construed in many different ways, but right now, the future is calling for our help. We will improve the world because we have been educated and equipped with those tools. We have been taught to stand for what is right, to learn from our errors, to dream, and to grow. We have been taught to live by the Charger Code, and we have been taught to use our education to develop our own thoughts to solve problems. Now, we are leaving high school and entering a new chapter of our lives, where we will probably continue to develop an unhealthy relationship with coffee, procrastination, and of course, all-nighters. Aside from that, we will remember that we have been fortunate and to have learned so much in a short 4 years. Robert Frost once said, "The only way around is through." And I think that sums up our class. Even when it's gotten tough, we have persevered through unprecedented times of crisis and of fear, and we will continue to do so. At the same time, we must keep in mind that trying times are only temporary, and we will get through this like we always have. We know that after things get better, they will worsen again because life has its ups and downs. But we have shown that we are capable of handling what comes next, whatever that is. For one, this year, we spent the last part of our iconic senior year entirely online. And while it isn't the same as having a senior skip day or a senior prank, we did make one very important discovery. We finally realized what Gen Z really stands for. We are Generation Zoom. And above that, even during a toilet paper shortage, we adapted to our circumstances with everything from virtual backgrounds to pet show and tells on screen. And we still managed to finish strong. Still, it is our responsibility to contribute to the progress that we look forward to. We will find ways to continue looking after each other. I am confident that with our combined strengths, we will make a difference in the world, and the world will never forget our historic class of 2020. I am so proud to be a small part of our truly amazing class, and I cannot wait to see what we accomplish. Congratulations, everyone.
Good evening. Graduating seniors, what a great journey it's been. And teachers, coaches, faculty, and staff, our thanks goes out to all of you who made our journey possible, and especially to those of you who will continue to lend your support to us as we continue on our paths wherever they might lead. And to the special group of teachers, administrators, and the HHSPA who worked tirelessly to ensure that our end-of-year celebrations could be as great as possible we extend our sincere gratitude. But most of all, I would like to say thank you to the parents, grandparents, families, and friends who gave us the seen and unseen support that we didn't always know we needed. Graduates, what a great story we will have to tell our children and grandchildren about what it was like to be a teenager in the year 2020. I mean, we didn't just get a senior skip day, we got a senior skip half semester. We could sleep in almost every day, go to class in our PJs, order Postmates, and binge watch Tiger King on Netflix. And on top of all that, we didn't even have to worry about our grades slipping. Okay, now pretend for a moment that what I just described to you, I had told you would happen this time last year. If for some wild reason you believed me, you'd be ecstatic. I mean, what a great way to end high school. I just said your grades wouldn't slip and that you could pretty much relax all you wanted during the spring of your senior year, something I'm sure every one of us has dreamed about at one point or another. But what if I also told your past self, right after, that everything I said would come at a cost? No spring sports, no in-person performing arts, debate, or choir, no going out to restaurants, spending face-to-face time with friends, or traveling. And maybe your family would even suffer from such a financial downturn that your future would seem uncertain. Would you still take the deal? Probably not. You would think about what was truly important in your life and would realize that everything worth keeping requires hard work and persistence. When we look back on our lives after high school, we won't look back and wish we had given up the things we loved to make our lives easier in the moment. In fact, I bet that the opposite will happen. We will have wished we had done more, seen more, helped more people, and spent more time with those we cared about and loved. If this pandemic has taught me anything, it is that I would rather live a life with more responsibility, more work, and yes, even more stress, if it meant I could enjoy everything life has to offer. This being said, I hope none of us ever misses out on an opportunity because we were too afraid of the commitment, the work, or the time we would need to invest in it. We will get out of this life what we put into it. So we have to ask ourselves, how do we want our story to be told? And now that we have the right tools, experience, and support, let's go out and tell it. Thank you.
Good evening. The Heritage Hall Alumni Association seeks to stimulate and nurture a spirit of pride, knowledge, and lifetime commitment to the mission and welfare of Heritage Hall. Class of 2020, on behalf of the 3,500 former Heritage Hall students who accepted their diplomas on a night like this, well, not like a night like this, I would like to welcome you to the Heritage Hall Alumni Association. Since 2012, the Alumni Association has annually recognized a graduate who has exemplified the Heritage Hall motto, to learn, to lead, to serve, by their personal accomplishments, professional achievements, or humanitarian services. Previous winners of this distinguished alumni award were pioneers in their own right, each living unique stories, yet all sharing common threads of compassion and the betterment of the community. This year's recipient of the award hails from the outstanding class of 1988. I was a classmate of Steve Magnus for many years at Heritage Hall. I remember Steve personifying the term Mr. All Around. He excelled in the classroom as a challenge scholar, where he was annually listed on the honor roll. Steve continues to be one of the most decorated athletes in Charger history, being a state wrestler, an elite competitor in both track and field, and setting numerous records at tailback. Certainly, Steve was a leader not only in the classroom and on the field, but he was a leader in the hallways. It was common for him to rally others to support school-sponsored charities. Steve was the guy who could instantly get 40 classmates to show up to help build a homecoming float or join a club. By all accounts, Steve was destined to do great things. After graduating in 1988, Steve attended Pepperdine University and played lacrosse for the Mighty Waves. He finished his undergraduate degree at SMU, where he also resumed his football career for the Mustangs. But the field of medicine tugged at Steve's heart, and he attended OU Medical School, where he met his wife, Ashley. Steve completed his residency in general surgery at OU Med and has practiced in Oklahoma City for the past 19 years. Steve and Ashley have two children, Caleb, currently attending OU, and Mary Kate, who is also Norman bound. He has completed 24 marathons and ultramarathons and is an avid recycler. But the story doesn't end there. Almost 4 years ago, Steve joined the Naval Reserves. Last August, Steve was called to active duty where he served as a trauma surgeon in several Role 2 and Role 3 hospitals in Afghanistan. His tour was recently completed in early June and he has been promoted to commander. Steve has just finished his mandatory quarantine just in time to be here tonight for Mary Kate's graduation. There's nothing more precious to Steve than his family, nor his family to Steve. The deployment required each member of the Magnus clan to discover a little deeper level of dedication, tap into a little deeper level of faith, find a bit more strength. Their commitment to one another was essential in keeping the family together during a difficult time many of us can't imagine. Ashley, Caleb, Mary Kate, thank you for all that you've gave up for your country. Your husband, your dad, cannot be more proud of you. Steve, your sacrifice is also honored tonight. Your family could not be more proud of you. Magnus family, please know that your Heritage Hall family is equally proud of you all. It is with a great sense of joy, and on behalf of the Heritage Hall Alumni Association, I am pleased to present the 2020 Distinguished Alumni Award to Dr. Steve Magnus.
Down, but apparently over the last year I got old, so I'll do my best. Thank you, David, and thank you, Heritage Hall. I appreciate and am humbled by this award. Unless you have a major psychiatric disorder, I'm not sure that anybody should really feel deserving of this reward, but I am honored to accept it for my team. Sounds strange to discuss a team in this situation as there's no sports involved, but I was brought up on teams. And it requires a team to get through and accomplish anything in life. To get through medical school, I had to work hard. But so did my teachers, and so did my family. When I was in Afghanistan, I had Trauma Team Charlie with me every step of the way, and often Teams Alpha and Bravo, too, when things got really hairy. At home, my wife and kids managed work, school, chores, and my jobs as well. I've been blessed to have a lifetime of great teams and coaches. First would have to be my mom, who raised three boys while going to school and then work. She cracked the whip on three perfectly obedient children and sent all three on to either an MD, JD, or an MBA. At Heritage Hall, we had outstanding teachers, coaches, and mentors. People who were willing to tell you when you're acting like a punk, but also willing to praise you when you put in the work. Now, I have a wonderful wife and kids who are also perfectly willing to tell you when you're acting like a punk, but support me in doing their work and mine when needed. Thank you again to my friends, family, and Heritage Hall for this recognition.
My pleasure to introduce our guest speaker tonight, Mr. Peesh Patel, founder of Dream Big and best-selling author of Lead Your Tribe, Love Your Work. Mr. Patel has been featured in Inc., Forbes, Fast Company, TechCrunch, and Entrepreneur magazines. Prior to starting Dream Big, Mr. Patel was the founder and CEO of Digital Tutors, an online training platform that focused on training artists who work in the feature film and video game industry. He has had a chance to impact over 1.5 million professionals all over the world and has worked with industry leaders including Pixar, Apple, Ford, and NASA, to name a few. A longtime entrepreneurs organization member and past president of the Oklahoma City chapter, he spends his time helping companies grow their revenue by leveraging their greatest asset, their employees. Most importantly, he is the proud father of his favorite son, 2020 graduate Nick Patel. Please welcome Mr. Peesh Patel.
Thank you for that kind introduction. Well, 2020 was a year of challenges, heartache, uncertainty, sorrow, and I'm just talking about the NBA. I miss the NBA. COVID shook the world. Who knew that toilet paper was the thing to hoard? Homeschooling went mainstream. Peaceful protests faced off with riots. And folks, it's not even July yet. So I have no shortage of material to pick from and what to share with you tonight, but I thought I'd do something different. Today, I'm going to talk about success, love, and change. So a little bit about me real quick. I grew up in El Reno, Oklahoma. I used to be a sixth grade science teacher, a college professor teaching computer graphics, a U.S. Army sniper, an entrepreneur. I own a winery in Napa, a brewery here in Oklahoma City. I'm an angel investor for a dozen companies, mentor, an ordained minister, and a published author. And I can read your mind right now. You're thinking, did he say sixth grade science teacher? I know, I'm just kidding. Many of you are thinking, I thought he was a doctor. My wife Lisa and I have one child. He's our favorite child. I always kid with him that if we had more than one, maybe he wouldn't be my favorite. You can only have one favorite. No, Nick is graduating with you today, who is our favorite. All young people need to go through a rite of passage, and graduation serves as that rite of passage for many Americans. And I've overheard many of you share your disappointments, and I understand them. No prom, no parties. That's probably it, right? No prom, no parties. A delayed graduation. However, if you were graduating high school in 1970, many of you young men wouldn't be sitting here. You'd be getting ready to go off to Vietnam, and many of you would not be coming home. Nick, I ran your birthday. And believe it or not, your name would have been called. I also looked up your two roommates for next year, and their names were not called. So you would not be at this graduation. You'd be getting ready for deployment. So I want you to pause for a second and just reflect on the men and women who have allowed you to be here today in a safe place to have your rite of passage. When those soldiers come home in coffins, no one ever asks, is that a black guy in that coffin? Is it an Asian in that coffin? Is it a white guy in that coffin? Underneath that flag is an American. Now, 2020, your class is going to have the burden to heal us and remind us that we're Americans first. What you're seeing in the world is change. Change is hard for all of us as we get older. We get used to predictability. And that's, I think, why kids are so eased to change. They're willing to change whenever they need to. So today I'm going to talk about what's going to be the biggest difficulty in your lives. And that's going to be the rate of change that you're about to experience. As much as you'd like the media to think that the immigrants are taking your jobs, blue-collar jobs have been taken by robots faster and faster. I know, I invest in them. And by the time you graduate college in just 5 years, AI is coming after your white-collar jobs. So you're gonna have to be ready for change. How are you gonna prepare? First I wrote, I have no idea how you're gonna prepare. Then I thought about it. Actually, what you need to do is be curious and a problem solver, because the jobs that you're gonna have don't exist yet. So you're gonna have to be curious about what you're gonna do and then be passionate about solving it. Now, I know what you're thinking. That is way far in the future. We're just talking about 6-7 years before there's a human brain of computing power in your pocket. And we're only 5 years from there from having 5 human brains in your pocket. I attended the Singularity University in San Francisco, and the things that I saw there and learned about what's coming around the future will blow your minds. And it's so far out there and so sci-fi that we can't even talk about it. So we don't talk about it, but it's gonna impact you greatly. Peter Diamandis, one of the co-founders, said, "Tomorrow's rate of change will make today feel like we're crawling." And just think about that. Like, the computing power is happening fast. There's two key reasons for this. Moore's Law, which you guys are all graduating from a wonderful private school. You should know what that is. I'm looking around, everybody's like, yeah, we do, don't ask me. Moore's Law, for those in the audience who don't know, means every couple of years, the computing power will double while the price will drop in half, meaning we're gonna get faster and faster computers as they get closer and closer to almost free. You take that and you combine that with connectivity and the world really changes. So connectivity is one of the things I think you guys should really focus on as you're thinking about this. We gotta change two things in connectivity. We gotta change censorship, so places like North Korea and China where you can't get access to information. And we need to change infrastructure. Now I can talk about countries in Africa that have terrible internet service, but I also know some small towns in Oklahoma that have terrible internet service. Elon Musk is working on that right now. He's already got 400 satellites in the sky. There's gonna be 2,000 more by next year, and this will create a global high-speed internet that no country or government can suppress. Think about your market size. Think about the change. Folks, it's here. Nick started Heritage Hall in the fourth grade, and boy, was it a lot of change for all of us. Now, we used to have a short 2-minute walk, and now we had a 15-minute drive. At his old school, we knew all the teachers, all the administrators. At Heritage Hall, we didn't know anybody, but we came on blind faith. Faith that the Heritage Hall core values of moral courage, personal responsibility, act of kindness, and intellectual purpose would be lived by all the staff, but especially the students. On the first day, we were befriended by two families, Maya and Trudy. You guys took Nick in. You showed him what great friendships are, and you showed him the Heritage Hallway. You guys have become great friends to Lisa and I as well. I've watched you two young ladies live the core values and represent Heritage Hall. Regina, Lorenzo, as well as Claudia, they welcomed us into the Heritage Hall family. They welcomed us into their homes and their hearts. Maya and Trudy, Lisa and I would like to give each of you $5,000 to use towards your freshman year of college. Or you can save it for a rainy day. This is an investment in your future, it's not a gift. We want you to go out into the world, continue to create positive change for others, and I want you to know that your small acts of kindness were not forgotten nor overlooked. So I want to share something personal with you. When Nick turned 10, I told him that he's on his way to becoming a young man, and when he turns 17, we're gonna go on a week-long trip, and we can go anywhere in the world you wanna go. So last summer, he said, I want to go to Japan. And so my goal was, we're going to leave as father and son, and we're going to return as two men who mutually respect each other. We had a week-long adventure, 24 hours. We shared a room. I don't know if you've shared a room with a teenager in a while, but we shared a room. We ate our dinners together, and ultimately we had lots of meaningful conversations. Now, I emailed my wife and said, hey, email me anything you've always wanted to ask him and I'll kind of work it in. So she said, I only have one question. I want to know what he's afraid of. Well, I can tell you at 17, I was afraid of like 1,000 things, right? And I was nervous about even more. So at dinner, I said, Nick, hey, what are you afraid of in the future? And he said, Dad, I'm afraid I won't be as successful as you and Mom. My heart sank. So I said, what does success look like to you? And he said, well, I've got to make more money than you and Mom. And he could see the stunned look on my face, so he added on top, oh, and I'm also afraid I won't fall in love like you and Mom. It was all I could do to hold back those tears and choke those back. And you know, I wondered in that moment, where in the world did he get this from? And then I realized he got that from me. See, when I was 17, I went to a goal-setting workshop, and they said, write out your goals. And I said, goals? You mean like go to college? Because that's a big goal, right? I'm the first in my family to go to college. I didn't grow up with much, so success was measured by stuff, accomplishments, and wealth. So I wrote down that I wanted to own a Corvette by 30 and one day have a Lamborghini, and the guy said, you're not thinking big enough. So I said, okay, I want to be a millionaire by 30 and retire by 40, because when you're 18, 40 is so far away. I can tell you, looking back, I'm like, ugh, should have thought a little longer. I also wrote down that I wanted to fall in love with someone on my own terms. Arranged marriage was still kind of on the table with my folks. My folks are here tonight, so I'm gonna be careful what I say. Well, I believe in self-fulfilling prophecy. Now, I did not get my Corvette by 30. I actually totally forgot about that goal, but I remembered it 3 days before my 31st birthday. So I went out and got an orange Corvette. I generated my first million by 29, and I got to retire at 40. But my greatest goal was I got to fall in love and marry somebody on my own terms. And the funny thing is, I didn't really have much to do with it. I ended up marrying my eighth grade pen pal from Nebraska, and we've now been married 21 years. So I guess in a way that one was a little bit arranged. So I thought success was all about reaching those goals. I only slept a few hours a night. I worked 7 days a week. But my wife has taught me that true success is beyond money, it's beyond stuff, and she's right, it's beyond cars. It's about character, giving, and how you behave when nobody's looking. For the longest time, I was married to my work, and I dated my family. And I know many of the parents in this audience, past and present, you've had to have this struggle. I understand the sacrifice that has to be made when you're trying to be present at games, concerts, all the school meetings, and honestly, I wasn't always present. So that day in Japan, I put my arm around Nick, and I said, son, making more money than me, that's not success. I said, if you can be a better father, a better husband, and a better friend, you will be the most successful person I'll ever meet. You should have seen the weight lifted off this kid. More importantly, though, it was powerful to let him know that he had permission to be himself, to find success as he defined it. But honestly, it was equally powerful for me that I released myself from the pressure to define my success through his. Right? We have to do that as parents. As far as falling in love, we were returning to our hotel on the subway, and I told him, look around, kid. Every single person on that subway had their heads buried in the phone. Falling in love is already hard enough to do. It's really hard when you're not looking at the person. Now, I'm a tech guy, but tech is keeping all of you from finding your soulmates because you're making decisions with a swipe and not your heart. So when you find your soulmate, respect them, learn from them, as my wife always reminds me, to listen to them. Now, before I wrap up, I want you guys to give a very healthy round of applause to your family, your friends, the teachers, the administrators. They've earned it. Let's give it to them. And there's a whole group of people that really deserve a round of applause. And these are the folks who work behind the scenes. The security, groundskeepers, cafeteria, all the people who make Heritage Hall what Heritage Hall is. So let's give them a big round of applause, too. All right. So I'm going to leave you with one final quote from the late, very great Rodney Dangerfield. To all you graduates, as you go out into the world, my advice to you is, don't go. It's rough out there. Move back in with your parents and let them worry about it. Congratulations, class of 2020.
Seniors, parents, and friends like each of you, I'm thrilled that we're able to be here tonight, finally, to honor the class of 2020. It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. Dickens said it best in his A Tale of Two Cities. You, my friends, were saddled with quite the spring, as been mentioned already, one which brought forth several historical events which have been most unsettling, to say the least. I've said this to many of you that I've seen in person this spring, but once again I'll say it. I'm sorry that this happened to you and that this chaos happened, but as time marches forward, hopefully you're going to greet your future with new positive approaches to life, changes that are going to improve our walk as a whole as we carry on. Now, seniors, you can't replay the spring, but you can start anew. The future is now. In front of you is a future that allows you to pursue whatever, and let me stress whatever, you choose to do. As you move on and grow in both experience and age, I hope you find both happiness and success in all you do. So my biggest fear in 21 years of doing this is that the guy in front of me kind of talked about what I was going to talk about. So I'm going to talk a little success, but not the type of success he was talking about. So bear with me. Happiness, I hope your happiness is viewed not only from the ground level, but also from 30,000 feet. Every day is not going to be the happiest, but in the grand scheme of things, you can choose a nice, happy existence, one which is not based on immediate gratification, but rather on the long term. I hope you find success. Everyone has their own personal definition of what it means to be successful. I was looking for a simple definition for success in the dictionary, no, online, right? And of course, up popped 19 definitions of success. It's just not easy to find that. I'm not going to share them all, but here are a few that will possibly hit close to home for some of you. Success is always doing your best. Success is having a place to call home. Success is understanding the difference between need and want. Success is learning that sometimes you can say no. Success is knowing your life is filled with abundance. Success is overcoming fear. Success is learning that losing a few battles can help you win a war. Success is not giving up. And success is celebrating the small victories. So one success can be measured in many ways. Sometimes you need to think outside the box and not get so caught up in society's definitions of what it means to be successful. And by some of these definitions that I've just listed, many of you may already be living a highly successful life. I wish you only the best in your quest for happiness and success. So speaking on behalf of the faculty, please remember this. We love you all. We're going to miss you tremendously. And we hope you'll take the time to come back and see us. So let your hook always be cast, for in the stream where you least expect it, there may be a fish. I wish you the very best of luck. Now to all present, I wish to declare that these Heritage Hall students have completed all academic requirements for graduation. Therefore, it is with much honor and pride that I present to you, Mr. Bramble, the Heritage Hall graduating class of 2020. Congratulations.
Mr. Castle, Mr. Patel, members of the Board of Trustees, my faculty colleagues, parents, relatives, and friends of the graduating class of 2020. We have gathered this evening to recognize and to celebrate our children. The faculty and staff members of Heritage Hall rejoice in this celebration. Like you, parents, we too have labored in the vineyards, and the young men and women who sit appropriately between us are the fruit of our joint labors. 24 members of this class have been here since the fall of 2008, their first grade year. We refer to them affectionately as lifers. 13 seniors are the children of Heritage Hall graduates. And as a personal milestone,
Brink Hall, Caitlin Hanna, Lauren Paik, and Drew Taylor are the most recent of the 19 Heritage Hall seniors whose parent I have graduated. Collectively speaking, these seniors have grown up in and with Heritage Hall. They are the ever-changing leaves on an institutional tree whose trunk has grown in girth and height over the last 50 years. These seniors have earned numerous academic awards and scholarships, as well as individual and team championships in a broad array of competitions during the past 4 years. And they've completed over 10,000 hours of community service since entering the upper school. The class of 2020 has provided both leaders and team players, and their contribution to the quality of life at Heritage Hall has been significant. It is thus with pride and pleasure that I accept the members of the class of 2020 for the presentation of their diplomas.
Will the first two rows please rise? Jagger Creed Nico Abels. Cole Lee Allen. Max Franklin Bates. Maya Joy Banks. Ryder Powell Bates. Sukanya Bhattacharya. Alexandra Rowan Black. Hardin Christopher Bowers. Carson Brady. Nathaniel David Branscombe. Mary Blair Brawley. Avery Caitlin Brown. Baker Cole Burns. Sean K. Chopra. Carter Stephen Cole. Heidi Ann Cook. James Edward Brooks Cook II. Kenneth Emmanuel Dowdy III. Kylie Taryn Deer. Will Dunn. Lale Adela Adele. Matthew Lewis Egger. Jay Douglas Ephraim. Amaris Elise Esau. Tyler Brooks Ferringer. Rains Drake Faulkner. Madison Fisher. Genesis Junia Franks. Avery Elizabeth Freeman. Cameron Ann Fulkerson. Thomas Malloy Gare. Rhodes Byron Haggard. Brink Franklin Hall. Caitlin Brooke Hannah. Nicholas Zane Herman. Alexandria Grace Hickey. Elliot Fletcher Horton. William Gray Jackson. Jalen Ray Johnson. Parker Scott Kays. Connor Hogan Keith. Landry Watts Kyle. Larissa Christina Leite. Dylan Vern Lewis. Ellie Grace Lewis. Logan Elizabeth Longacre. Edwin Lorne Jr. Henry C. Lowry. Mary Catherine Magnus. Kayla Morshe Marshall. Kennedy Michelle Maddox. Dylan Ethan Mayo. Noah Glenn McAdams. Matthew McClintock. Grant Harrison McLean. Blake Oakley Miller. Skylar Alexis Mooneyham. Alexander Min Nguyen. Alex was unable to attend tonight. Ella Elizabeth Owen. Ella was unable to attend tonight. Caitlin Alexandria Palmer. Lauren Morgan Pake. Madison Nicole Pardoon. Nicholas Patel. Audrey Catherine Payne. Evan William Pearson. Aiden Don Pizzold. John Emmerich Pittman. Jack was unable to attend tonight. Paul Allen Plowman. Pierce Rappaport. Catherine Tabby Ross. Sophia Leon Salim. Seth Yulah Kamran Salim. Hayden William Schrod. John William Shepherd III. Cooper Charles Shelton. Abigail Margaret Sikowski. Kayla Ann Singh. David Colin Smith. Philip Smitherman. Joseph John Sumner Bacon Spanier II. James Roebling Stiglitz. Bo was unable to attend tonight. Drew Elizabeth Taylor. Trudy Spybuck Taylor. Benjamin Chanette. Layla Noelani Thomas. David Benjamin Turner. Rip Francis Turrentine. Jake Reynolds Wilhelm. Hugo Conrad Williams. Matthew Evan Williams. Reagan Nicole Williams. Anna Lee Young. Joshi Candy Yuen.
Class of 2020 will please rise. On behalf of the Board of Trustees, the faculty, and the administrative staff, it is my duty, my honor, and my privilege to declare you graduates of Heritage Hall with all of the rights and privileges that obtain. Congratulations to all.
Hi, everyone. First of all, I cannot go without thanking each and every one of the loving families in the audience. You are the reason the class of 2020 has come so far. I'd like to congratulate you on raising the very capable young men and women I am lucky enough to call my classmates. I'd also like to thank the extraordinary faculty of Heritage Hall who have welcomed us into school each day with open arms. And of course, I want to thank the class of 2020 for being some of my greatest friends and for helping me become a better person over the past 4 years. But no matter who you are, there's one thing we all have in common. We all love numbers. They make us feel comfortable. When asking how big, how many, or every parent's favorite, how much longer until we get there, an answer of very big, only a few, or a long time never satisfies us. We want a number. But our love for numbers has a downside. You see, numbers are so important to our lives that we often try to use them to quantify ourselves. And as much as the unquantifiable feels scary, the fact of the matter is that you can't quantify what makes each of us so beautifully human. When I began high school as a new student at Heritage Hall, I wanted to focus more on the person I would become rather than the numbers I would achieve. I tried to instill in myself the characteristics I admired in those around me. And my new peers provided plenty of inspiration. Every member of Heritage Hall's class of 2020 has many traits that I am still trying to emulate. But what makes this class so special is that every individual is truly recognized for their strengths. Sukanya Bhattacharya is one of only a few Heritage Hall students to complete 2 independent study projects. Despite this, the class of 2020 will always know her for the way she never backs down from a challenge. Reagan Williams has scored high marks on 2 AP art portfolios and has submitted a 3rd that certainly will not be an exception. To her classmates, however, Reagan is known for always being the most true version of herself. In men's soccer, Parker Kays is a 2-time member of the all-district team and earned a coveted spot on the all-state team this year. But the seniors graduating here today know Parker for the way he makes life fun. By telling jokes and anecdotes, he's always looking to make his classmates' day a little brighter. Skylar Mooneyham is involved heavily in all 3 pillars of Heritage Hall life. In academics, she is a strong student. In athletics, she is a cheerleader and volleyball player. And in the arts, she performs the violin in all of Heritage Hall's shows. But the first thing the class of 2020 will remember Skylar for is her courage. She isn't afraid to stand up for what's right. Nate Branscombe demonstrates 3-pillar involvement as well. In academics, he is a passionate learner. In athletics, he spent 2 years on the football team. And in the arts, he's performed in many Heritage Hall musicals. Yet Nate's classmates will always see him for his strong discussion skills. He listens before he talks, genuinely considering what others have to say. Avery Freeman's athletic record as a Charger includes participation in 4 different sports: basketball, track, volleyball, and soccer. When she begins classes at the University of Oklahoma in the fall, she will add rowing to her already impressive resume. The class of 2020, however, will always remember Avery for the way she genuinely wants the best for everyone with whom she crosses paths and will go to great lengths to help them achieve it. Drew Taylor and Cameron Fulkerson both have 4 state championship medals in cheerleading. But at Heritage Hall, Drew's legacy is that of her constant kindness, and Cameron's is the absolute dedication with which she performs each task. no matter how small. David Turner has earned 6 superior ratings at the state level for his solo and ensemble performances on violin. But the Heritage Hall community knows him for his especially hardworking nature, which, mixed with his great talent, is the secret behind not only his musical successes, but his stellar academics. In her Heritage Hall soccer career, Jalen Johnson has made 13 goals and has 6 assists, stats that helped her score a spot on Freed Hardeman University's team. But Jalen's classmates recognize her for the dedication she puts into maintaining positive relationships with those close to her, including the animals with which she works at the zoo. Philip Smitherman has scored a career 18 touchdowns on Heritage Hall's football team and will be playing for Harvard University in the fall. But the class of 2020 will always recognize Philip for his incredible humility. Seth Saleem is one member of the first duo to bring a national debate championship to Oklahoma in 54 years. Yet, other Chargers see Seth firstly for his abundance of intellectual curiosity, which will allow him to succeed in any of the many, many career paths in which he is interested. Avery Brown has accrued close to 800 community service hours throughout her high school career. At Heritage Hall, however, this number does not define her. Rather, it is the love she has for those who need her help. Cooper Shelton is a talented musician whose top song has been streamed over 62,000 times on Spotify. These graduating Chargers know him not for this number, but for the overwhelming amount of passion he has for his craft, which can be seen in the fact that Cooper can often be found using spare time during lunch, break, or study hall to perfect his next hit. Candy Ewan is an accomplished dancer who, at her most recent competition, helped her team to a jazz group dance, placing in the top 3 and a contemporary group in the top 5. At the same competition, which happened to be her first, her solo won its category. Yet, Chargers will firstly tell you about Candy's sweet smile and enthusiasm for life, even on the bad days. Now, in no way am I trying to downplay the amazing accomplishments of the class of 2020. Each of its members has impressive achievements that are worthy of our respect and admiration. And unfortunately, no matter how much I want to do so, time does not permit me to mention all of my classmates individually. But what is perhaps even more extraordinary is the way in which no student in the class of 2020 is defined by the sum of their accolades. We see each other and have grown to see ourselves not as something that must be counted or measured, but as someone who deserves to love and be loved. And so here is my challenge to the class of 2020. As we wrap up this particular chapter in our lives, we are in the unique position to use this strength to our advantage. We could easily let ourselves be defined by the number 35, the number of class days by which our senior year was cut short. But just because we could doesn't mean we should. We are once again faced with the task of being human, not numerical. Time after time, we have proven ourselves to be more than our statistics. And I know we can do it again. That's part of the class of 2020 mindset. You see, even at 18 years old, my classmates have a clear understanding of what is really important in life, cultivating strong relationships with those around them. And because it's pretty hard to relate to someone if you only see them as a number, each one of them has made a point of knowing others for their characters. For the past 4 years, I have gone to school every day, excited and proud to be a Charger because my classmates helped me realize that I am far more than the sum of my accomplishments. To the class of 2020, I cannot thank you enough for this immeasurable gift. I do not think you could ever understand how much of a positive impact this has had on my life. So, the next time you ever begin to think that you don't measure up, just remember that you shouldn't be measuring at all. If the class of 2020 can teach you anything, is that the best part about you is that you are human. Now, go on and do the big things I know you are destined to do. I can't wait to hear about them when life entangles our paths once more. Thank you.
I got a feeling that tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good, good night. A feeling that tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good, good night. Let's do it. 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 Let's do it.